The debt ceiling deal is done. So what does this mean for you? What do these cuts mean for you? Don Peebles is chairman of the Peebles Corporation. It's a real estate developer. He's also a member of President Obama's National Finance Committee. The Economic Policy Institute estimates that the debt ceiling deal will cost America 1.8 million jobs by 2012. Now, most of those are expected to be government jobs. Don, you're an employer. Do you think that we're going to see job loss as the nation tries to tighten its belt? Does something like this, the debt ceiling deal, make you as an employer have to hire fewer people?
Well, no, I don't think it helps me make me have to hire fewer people. But what it does do is it gives us a little more stability. The irony here, though, is the debt ceiling has been increased 74 times in my lifetime.
Right.
And I'm 51, so more than once a year, 10 times since 2001. So not a lot of impact here other than all the drama around it and further instability. I think the big challenge here is for the average American. They're not going to see much of an impact because Social Security is not getting touched, nor is Medicaid and Medicare. And those are the big drivers of our budget deficits where we can't control them. And so
we'll talk a little bit more about those as we go on. Diane Lim Rogers is chief economist of the Concord Coalition. Some of the cuts in this debt deal were going to come from loans to graduate students. Diane, when the job market finally turns around, will we have a workforce that's educated and ready to compete if we're starting to pull back some of the subsidies to get middle-class kids into college?
Pretty troubling that the areas of budget cutting that Congress and the President managed to do happen to be those that will most adversely affect our younger people. They're the ones that are going to be stuck with the bills later on. So it'd be nice if we at least set aside enough resources for them to get a good education.
But you know, Diane, you've studied this for so long, you know, talking about fiscal austerity, you know, paying for the life we can afford, not the life we think in this country we want to live. I mean, it is clear that we are in a period now, and American families should understand, we're in a period now where we can't pay for all the things our government has promised.
That's right. We can't. And unfortunately, Congress did not really demonstrate, or the administration, that we're ready to confront those tough choices. As Don mentioned, the biggest pressures on the federal budget are the entitlement programs, the payments to Medicare and Social Security, and the great mismatch between revenues and those spending programs. But we didn't touch those this time around. And Congress and the President haven't really set up a great mechanism to force them to confront those choices the next round either.